So here we are again. As the more alert of you may have noticed, there has been a slight change in the political terrain since we gathered here last year, when the collective wisdom was he's not serious, he's not really going to run, he can't possibly be nominated. Remember David Brooks? And there's no way he can be elected. That wisdom survived till about 8:15 p.m. on the night of election night. So the focus of this series is now what? How will the president, unlike any we have ever had, govern? How will and should those oppose him act? And how does journalism cover a president in a time when the whole idea of facts seems under siege by the White House and many of its more powerful media allies? The series will conclude on April 23rd with a return visit by Maggie Haberman and Alex Burns of the New York Times. But I want to make a special note of the guest 2 weeks from tonight, who is Hugh Hewitt. He is one of the most influential voices on the American right and one of the smartest. He is not Sean Hannity. He is not Rush Limbaugh. He is a Washington Post columnist. He's a regular on MSNBC and NBC. And I mention this because for those of you who pride yourselves on having an open mind and wanting to listen to all points of views, I've noticed that with some people that works up until the point they hear something they don't like. And so if you are interested in hearing what a very smart person has to say from a very different perspective, I urge you to come on March 26th and listen to Hugh Hewitt. Now, I obviously don't have to make a pitch tonight about that. For one thing, you're here. And the second, most of you know in one way or another the work of Frank Rich in a variety of different arenas for a very long time, from his years as chief theater critic of the New York Times, to his op-ed writings as a columnist for the Times, to his articles and conversations with New York Magazine. You've been reading his opinions on matters cultural and political for decades. And if you're a devotee of Veep, soon to begin, I think it's sixth season, he'll correct me, on HBO, you are a consumer of Frank's work because he serves as executive producer of the show, not to mention his award-deserving performance as Chief Justice last season. Now, I am not suggesting that Frank Rich comes here as a dispassionate neutral. I think that would be inaccurate. But what I do suggest, and what I really enjoy about reading Frank, is that that what he has to say is buttressed by a very deep dive, as the journalists say, into research, into specifics. I have no idea whether you're going to leave tonight encouraged or race home to pull the covers over your head, but we might as well find out. Ladies and gentlemen, Frank Rich. Oh, there you are. Have a seat. So I want to begin with your work as a mogul. You're a mogul now. I've written a lot of alternate histories, and all this past year, people have said to me, why don't you do an alternate history about this campaign, to which I've always said, no, this is the alternate history. And I raise that because I wonder, from the perspective of an executive producer of Veep, looking to stretch politics to the absurd, did the election of Trump in any way pose a challenge for this season, given the reality?
Of course. I think that just as everyone in journalism is sort of rethinking what makes sense, what works, what can you do in this environment, it's been an issue for anyone dealing with fiction about politics. I feel very lucky about Veep. I mean, the new season, which we literally just finished shooting a week ago and which goes up on the air on HBO in mid-April, people have to judge it for themselves, but we were lucky. We were lucky in two ways. First of all, the whole idea of Veep from the beginning has been that we never reference contemporary politicians, and indeed, our heroine, if that's the right word for the character that Julia Louis-Dreyfus plays, we never identify her political party or the political party of anyone in the show, and so that gives us a certain freedom. And we, you know, when there's shows like Parks and Rec that have had, you know, John McCain and Nancy Pelosi do cameos, we don't do any of that. We've never referenced any president later than Reagan in the show. So that helps us because it's, and the where that comes from reflects the original creator of the show, who's British, Armando Iannucci, but also my conviction as someone who grew up in Washington, and I would also add, Julia's conviction, and we've talked about it on the stage, as someone who grew up in Washington, that the Washington we want to satirize, it's always there. People come and go. So that helps us. But the other thing that helped us was just sheer luck. Last season, the season that aired last spring, Veep had a tumultuous, crazy election. And luckily, it had aired by the time Trump ascended, just. And so if we were airing that season starting in April, we'd be screwed, because you could not top what happened here in 2016. Instead, we have a situation by just sheer luck where Selena Meyer, our character, this is a spoiler for those who didn't see last season, lost. She's an out of work former president trying to put together a private post-presidential life in New York City. So we're not in the news in quite the same way. But people have to see whether it's funny or not. But I will say this, on the night of the election, by happenstance, we were shooting a scene that was set in the country of Georgia, but actually was shot in Pasadena, California, where Selena, as an ex-president, was supervising a corrupt election in a polling place, so corrupt that two of her aides voted by accident in it. It's like finding the wrong way to the men's room or whatever. It was very surreal, and then the returns came in and people were extremely upset. And we sort of took a pause, because like everyone else, I think, who has been thrown by the Trump victory, you question all sorts of things about what you're doing in life, including, can you even be funny about politics? It's an existential question. We pulled ourselves out of it, but it's not like we didn't take a pause.
Well, I raise it also because a couple of years ago, Alan Zweibel and Dave Barry wrote a political farce, called, I think, Ludicrous. It was bought by the movies. And in their book, to make things completely, insanely farcical, the wacko guy they were running for president was running against Donald Trump. And Hollywood is now saying to them, what? Where do we go beyond that?
But yeah, so, I mean, just one other thing. HBO announced that they're going to do a film, a nonfiction film, like they did with Recounting Game Change, yeah, about this election. How do you cast Trump? You're not going to cast Alec Baldwin. Right, you can't cast a movie that's supposed to be a serious depiction, not without humor, the campaign. But I don't even know how you cast an actor in that.
I don't know how you do the reality. So let's go back to this.
The real Trump.
Let's go back to Earth One. So there's this cottage industry that has grown up trying to explain what happened last November. And to some extent, it's like the five blind men with the elephant. You know, it's a snake. No, it's a wall. So without turning the next 90 minutes into an autopsy, let's either give me your unified field theory, here's what happened, or a few plausible explanations. And I don't know if you'd like to go, we have heard everything from the Russians did it, it was economic anxiety, cultural dislocation, racism, misogyny. Let's start with the one that might get this audience a little bit off their seats. Let's talk about the Democratic candidate for president.
Absolutely. I felt from the beginning, and have not been shy about it in print, that it was not a good campaign, and she was not an ideal candidate. I posed this in print like four times, and still no one has answered the question. Why, if you're running for president in an anti-establishment environment, where forget about Trump, you knew you were going to run against Bernie Sanders or someone like Bernie Sanders, and you knew what your own party's base felt, why would you give those speeches to Goldman Sachs? How much money do you need when you know you're going to run for president, that you're going to collect that money? The speeches were anodyne. Of course they were, the kind of speech you'd expect.
Man's role in a changing world.
Yeah, exactly.
Or woman's role in a changing world.
Yeah, I mean, but why would you do it? In fact, she spoke to like 80 different banks for a total of $18 million. between when she got out of the State Department and running. I just don't understand it. That's just the tip of the iceberg of a campaign that never inspired any confidence. And what I wrote a piece, the first piece I wrote about Trump when he had not, when he was just running for the nomination, just beginning to pick up speed, one point I made was Trump was showing up, not just what was wrong with Jeb Bush's campaign, but was already showing up what was wrong with Hillary Clinton's campaign, where everything was so focus grouped and tested that literally, in a, I think it was a New Hampshire campaign stop at a like a frozen custard place, she was asked to name her favorite flavor of ice cream and could not name it because she might offend someone. So it was a very, so you have to ask, I feel they deserve a lot of responsibility. And also we kept hearing the same thing about, they were so scientific, they had a great ground game, they knew about the demographics. Anyone who remembered just 2008 would remember that was exactly what Clinton campaign, under different management, said when they were running against Obama in the primaries. The leadership of that campaign had changed, was still the same candidate, and clearly it began at the top. So, and also I never understood why they assumed that young people who were enthused about Bernie Sanders would necessarily turn up, and why they assumed that African Americans would turn up the numbers for her that they turned out the numbers for the first African American president of the United States.
This is like listening to my.
Yeah, myself. I want to hear what you.
No, because it tracks almost exactly. I can tell you why she gave those speeches. I don't know. I've never given speeches for that much money, but I have given speeches where people have paid. Well, it's the easiest way to make a lot of money in the world.
But they had plenty of money. Well, you know, and also look at the other thing. The Clinton Foundation. I always felt it was sort of a cesspool. I never quite understood it. I felt that it was. It means well, and of course, you know, doing good work, some good works, but it also seemed to be like, you know, the Aspen Ideas Institute and Renaissance Weekend, slightly one of these sort of event scams, I felt. But in any event, it was called the William Jefferson Clinton Foundation. Why, again, on the eve of running for president, was the name changed to the Bill, Hillary, and Chelsea Clinton Foundation, so then she could own, as she's running for president, every problem or conflict within it.
All right, let me.
I'm infuriated by the Clintons at this point. And I'm someone, you know, who's a liberal Democrat and voted for them both at various times, but it's just, I feel they really.
No, what I was channeling was that story about the flavor. I wrote in a column that listening to Secretary Clinton was like, there was like a 7-second delay in her head to make sure that she wasn't saying the wrong thing. 2 weeks later, the New York Times, one of her closest and longstanding allies, said precisely the thing. So that's one explanation. Let me flip to the other side. To what extent do you think that racial and gender, the polite word is dislocation, so let me put it more bluntly. To what extent was racism, misogyny, part of why she lost?
It certainly was a part. Certainly misogyny is a huge part. There's no question that there are lots of people, not just men, by the way, who have problems with women being in power.
And she won a majority of white women.
Right.
I mean, he did.
He did. He did.
Sorry.
Exactly. He did. And so, yes, that's an enormous problem. And racism, sure, and a lot of it's residual racism about Obama, besides, and rage in the Republican Party at its base about Obama and indeed about the whole gradual dwindling of the white demographic majority in America. So all of those things are factors. She's also running against the craziest candidate in the history of the country that's ever gotten to be president, let alone to get the nomination of a major party. And the fact is, she, in spite of all this, she won the popular vote and really lost by 78,000 votes distributed over three states.
1/30 of 1% of the vote. But here's the thing that intrigued me about there are a couple of factors about this. I'm going to leave out, you know, the Russians for a second. You know,
okay.
The idea that Comey screwed her. When an election's that close, you can appoint anything. If you look at the exit polls, you have to conclude, as a matter of math, that several million people voted for Donald Trump believing that he was neither fit nor qualified to be president.
Yep.
I want to say that again. Several million people voted for Donald Trump believing, saying he's not fit to be president, he's not qualified to be president, which suggests a kind of desire to upend things.
Blow things up.
To break up, to break the china on the part of just enough people who felt that whoever was in control, like you said about Washington, Republican, Democrat, we're getting the short end of the stick, or we're getting the shaft, prepared to do that with fully knowledgeable, or at least reasonably knowledgeable, that this guy had some serious issues.
Yeah, look, they did that, and yes, feeling that way, having, you know, conclusive evidence, you know, the Billy Bush video. I mean, there was so much, you know, he didn't release his income taxes. There's so much stuff. Yeah, there were people who were alienated and wanted to blow things up. And that was true from the Republican primaries forward. It was also true in the Democratic primaries to some extent. But it was, you know, Jeb Bush and Hillary Clinton were probably the last people who should have run for president in this cycle. And I'm not convinced, by the way, as some people are, that Bernie Sanders would have done better against Trump than, you know, he's still 74 years old, Jewish, and socialist. But
who was in 1980, this is my favorite fun fact of the whole campaign, in 1980, Bernie Sanders was an elector for the Socialist Workers' Party. For those of you not familiar with the internecine, that's the Trotskyist party. Not the Norman Thomas party. That's the Trotskyist party. And I have a feeling that might have come up.
Yeah, it might have come up, yeah. I think...
Can I just share one other thing to you?
Yeah.
Here's the one thing I know about Bernie Sanders. Somewhere in his record collection is the Weavers at Carnegie Hall.
Let's just... The one thing we don't want is to hear him sing along. But
I'm with you. I think that would have been a dicey...
I think that's sort of revisionist history. But I think that there are people who wanted to blow the country up, and now, you know what? They're going to get their wish, because they're going to be thrown off of health care. Coal mining is not coming back as a profession. There's not going to be a $1 trillion infrastructure plan that's going to employ people who... or out of work, and
I promise you, we're going to get to that.
Go ahead.
There's one more area about this, because just yesterday, and if I mispronounce his name, forgive me, the editor of the New York Times, Dean Baquet?
Baquet,
okay. Gave a talk, and he made two points that I thought were interesting. About one, he said, and Nate Silver made the same point in an article yesterday, there is a bubble in terms of journalism, that people all talk to each other within a very narrow frame of reference. The second thing he said was that we are, as a profession, journalism, big mainstream journalism, has become so secular that we don't understand, as an institution, the degree to which religious conviction and the political implications of that drive a lot of voters.
It's a little. I mean, Yes, there is a certain bubble, as you and I know well, within the press. But I feel. I don't think that what happened at the Times necessarily can be extrapolated to the entire press. The Times had some real problems covering this campaign, including having a statistical feature called the upshot that predicted right up until midday of election day that Hillary was a shoo-in. And that sort of, to me, is kind of Dewey beats Truman situation, very insular, that editors would not question that, I think. But I do feel I feel a lot of people miss the story. There's no question about it. And I felt that from the beginning, really, including a lot of conservative journalists and conservative commentators. On the religion thing, you know, 20 years ago, when the religious right was really, or 15 years ago, even when it was really at its peak, there was a lot of soul-bearing by the liberal media about reporters not understanding religion. Remember, there was that famous Washington Post story which referred to members of evangelical Christians as being easily led and duped, basically, that the Post had to spend 10 years apologizing for. But then what happened is everyone, including the Times, went and covered the bejesus out of this world, so to speak. Yes, I don't think that had any impact. I don't think that was the problem with the coverage of 2016.
I think I don't want to put words in the
case. Right, maybe now, I'm not understanding.
It may be that he was getting at was, for instance, how could the evangelical vote go so heavily for Trump after things like the Access Hollywood tape? You would think that would be a problem. And I think he was making the point that there was a lack of understanding that for a lot of those voters, if Donald Trump was going to make the Supreme Court pro-life, they didn't give a damn.
True. Yeah, that's absolutely true. That said, what's news about that? In the world of, you know, of all these megachurch evangelical ministers over the past 25 years being found in sex scandals, gay scandals, stealing scandals, that hypocrisy has always been, there's no bigger, you know, someone like Pat Robertson is like a walking hypocrite and has been for, you know, 3 or 4 decades. And I don't think, frankly, that's what had, yes, it's shocking that these evangelicals turned out for Trump in spite of him clearly not even knowing what the Bible is. The only book he's read is The Art of the Deal, and it's not clear, according to my friend Tony Schwartz, who actually wrote it, Trump ever read it. Really, what really made the difference was, as Trump himself said, "I love the poorly educated." He was put over by white working class voters without college degrees. He had the biggest, and I'm talking about working class, not poor whites, working class, above, which is defined as above $50,000 a year income. He won that group by 39%, which is bigger than anyone has ever won it in the history of exit polling since 1980. I think saying that the press didn't understand the religious hypocrisy doesn't explain very much.
All right, so
that wasn't what did the election.
So here we are. One of the things that's already been clear, it happened in the campaign and it continues to happen, is that Trump has managed to break all kinds of what is now being called norms with no consequences. I'm talking about post-election. The conflict of interest issue between himself and his family is at a level that is, it's like the last line of The Producers, you know. We find the defendants incredibly guilty. This is beyond belief. I mean, it's one step short of him going on, you know, Home Shopping Channel pitching a deal at the Trump Hotel. He had, you know, the tax returns, which he said we'd get. No, you're not going to get them. And he doesn't, no, you're not going to get them. Okay? His use of Twitter to opine, I guess during Shabbat when Ivanka and Jared aren't available. Okay, and the thing about this is, it has all happened, just like the Access Hollywood tape, just as all the stuff. And in terms of undermining his base or undermining the people who are going to be working with him within the Republican leadership, it hasn't mattered. They've literally just said, like Emily Latella on Saturday Night Live, never mind. So the question is, as long as these Republican leaders and the Republican base sees Trump instrumentally as the guy who will deliver to them their long dreamt of agendas, you see anything that could alter this course? Remember, he once said, "I could shoot somebody on Fifth Avenue."
Oh, I know. That's very accurate.
He's coming close to proving it.
I agree. I think there are let's talk about the base, and then let's talk about the establishment of the Republican Party, because I think it's two different things. I think in the case of the base, the hardcore Trump supporters who'd be happy for him to shoot someone on Fifth Avenue, and although it'd be hilarious to see him actually try to shoot a gun, because you know he'd be completely incompetent and probably shoot himself or something. But anyway, because he claims all this expertise about everything that he doesn't have.
Scattered applause for the idea of a man shooting himself, but we'll let that pass.
But I think that the base loves this stuff. They love it, including the evangelicals in the base. This is him giving the finger to everybody. Now, the situation with the Paul Ryans and Mitch McConnells is different. I'm sure some of them are genuinely offended. They, early on in the primary season, made a show of being somewhat critical of Trump. You know, it seems like a century ago when he called McCain, you know, a coward and all that stuff. But they all gradually retreated because they realized their voters, their base, loves it.
Right.
So what is going to change this equation? The only thing that's going to change the equation is if something happens that roils the base that then causes them to say to Paul Ryan and Mitch McConnell and the like, we've had enough. It will not be misbehavior by Trump. It will be a failure of government that's going to hurt them, I think. It's going to be they're cut out of Medicaid. They're cut out of health care. They find out that he's not delivering on this stuff.
And when he blames Obama for this, or if he blames traitors in the Republican Party, or rootless cosmopolitans, or international bankers, or the media, the question that I'm puzzling about is, will his followers say, you let us down? Or will they say, that's right, we're going to get rid of all the people who screwed you, we're going to redouble our efforts? I'm trying to figure out the mechanism by which even a policy failure rebounds against Trump.
Some policy failures won't. Like, his base didn't care that the first immigration edict was thrown out by the courts. He'll figure out a way. It's going to bother them when it's
not sure what's going on back there, but go ahead.
Yep. What's going to bother them is something involving their own pocketbooks, something directly affecting them. I don't think they're going to care if the wall isn't built. If they don't get jobs, if they lose their health care, if the mail doesn't come, and then Trump, of course, will try to, he blames everything on someone else. But it's a slight blessing in disguise that the Republicans control all three branches of government, because it'd be very hard to blame it on Obama for much longer. And so I feel, this is maybe somewhat Pollyannish of me, but I feel the best course for his decline is going to be when there's chaos, because he does not know how to govern the country.
Okay.
He's not even appointing people to the jobs of doing
that. This is true. Can somebody tell me what that? Oh, it's the mic. One of us is hitting the mic. One of us is being Jewish with our hands. That's what.
Okay.
It's okay. I will. It may be me. Thank you. Thank you. I thought somebody was rioting. So here's an interesting notion. You know Joe DiMaggio, or maybe it wasn't Joe DiMaggio, but I think it was, who supposedly said, I'd rather be lucky than good. So here's just one interesting statistic. So Trump's big immigration pitch, that's what he did the very first day that he announced, right? It turns out, if the New York Times is not doing fake news, that the immigration, people coming to the border, has dropped by 40% because they are getting the message all the way down in Central America that they're not wanted. Now, I almost hesitate to say this, but in one sense, I don't think he's smart enough to have exactly figured that out. That's a pretty cheap way of cutting down undocumented immigration. You don't have to build a wall. Just tell people, we don't want you, we're going to get you out. And if they stop showing up, do we count that as an achievement?
It's pure genius. It is an achievement, but it's an achievement that actually could backfire, because as we know, in places like, for instance, California and Florida and parts of the Midwest, which essentially depend on undocumented immigrant labor and are going nuts because they're going to lose people to pick vegetables and fruit, it could have a consequence that Trump's never thought about. He's never thought about the consequence of anything. He thinks he's just keeping out murderers and rapists, but the fact is it could have an economic issue, and this is why Republicans want, establishment Republicans had wanted immigration reform that could backfire in a way that he didn't expect. So yes, he can say, oh gosh, you know, it's because of me that undocumented immigrants are down 40%, but then if people can't get their orange juice, it's another story.
The other example where luck may be at least temporarily on his side is, I noticed that the minute he was elected, never mind the inauguration, everything was, Drudge turned into an optimist. You saw the first job reports, these phony baloney numbers, don't trust them, they're all lying. Oh, no, they're right now.
Right.
And if the economic forecasters are right, which is never a, you don't want to bet the farm on it, we're in for maybe a year of, you know, stable growth. And it is true that whoever's president always gets the credit or blame for what's going on under his or her watch.
Right.
So for the next year, in a macro sense, he'll be presiding, unless he manages single-handedly to destroy it, a pretty decent economy.
I agree. Where it could, though, haunt him is in the weakest parts of the economy, including people who voted for him who are unhappy with their wages, don't have jobs, or are unhappy with the jobs they have. They're not necessarily going to be helped by this. And right. They're not, and look, we know that a third of the Americans don't even know that the Affordable Care Act is Obamacare.
Oh,
and they're going to lose it, and they're going to not have health insurance, and they're not going to care about growth numbers or the Dow Jones, I don't think.
See, the
and that's the base. It's going to be good for people like us, possibly, but not necessarily for the people that brought him to the rodeo, as the cliche has it.
It looks to me like as if what the Republicans are desperate to do on the healthcare thing, which is giving them all kinds of fits, their right wing hates it, the moderate senators and governors in the states where Medicaid's been expanded are petrified, is that, let me tell you a brief story. Guy's at a bullfight. Vendor has a sign that says, hot meat pies, 20 pesos. Guy gives him 20 pesos, he buys into it. It's cold and doughy, and there's no meat. And the guy says to the vendor, it says it's a hot meat pie. And the vendor says, no, that's just the name of the pie. The point being, they're going to pass something come hell or high water, and they're going to call it Obamacare repeal and replace.
Right.
And it isn't going to matter to them what it is.
To people voting on it. Right.
The House and the Senate, they're going to ram this thing through as fast as they can. I mean, the idea that a committee got the bill Monday, wrote it out of committee Wednesday. Remember all the screaming about it, Obamacare? Read the bill? Anyway, they're going to pass something. And a lot of the mechanisms that kick in that are going to hurt the people you're talking about, they're going to delay.
Well,
as long as they can.
That's even, it, look, if so, it's clever. And they may be able to get away with it for a period of time. But of course, what's happened just in the past 24 hours is Trump having previously said, this bill is just the, you know, opening gambit and we're gonna negotiate it, has now said, no, I'm totally in favor of the Paul Ryan bill. And that doesn't fudge, a lot happens by 2018.
Let me switch gears for a second and talk about the business that, well, you're a mogul now, but you're still with the press, and I'm semi with the press. Obviously, trying to cover this president is a challenge unlike any, I think it's fair to say, that the press has ever faced. Again, Dean Becquet said, our job is not to oppose Trump, our job is to cover the hell out of him.
Mm-hmm.
At a time when the President of the United States has said in so many words, you're the enemy. So to what extent does the press have to change its norms of behavior? I noticed the New York Times in a couple of headlines used the word lie. I don't remember them ever doing that before.
No.
How do you stay in the role that you're supposed to stay in when you've got an administration basically defining anything you say as false and fake because it's coming from you?
You know, I don't think there are many options. I think that, you know, since the election, and even in the tail end of election season, the press was behaving as it should. You know, everyone said, oh, the press didn't, a lot of liberals said the press didn't investigate Trump properly. That's not true. They did everything. There was a lot of good investigative reporting on Trump before the election, and there continues to be almost every day a major story. And so that's what they should be doing, and of course they should use plain language, and if he's lying, they should say he's lying. However, in another weird way, none of it has anything to do with the price of the fish, because his base that supports him and that keeps Republican establishment supporting him is going to think it's all lies no matter what it is. You know, and they don't read it, and they don't consume it, and they are in another, this is the thing that a lot of Democrats, I think, don't understand, and they're in another media sphere entirely. It has its own equivalent of the New York Times, not in terms of quality or ethics, but it has, and it's not just Fox News. Fox News is actually sort of the left of this media sphere. During the 2012 campaign, I did a piece that was very trying to do for New York Magazine, which is I spent essentially 2 weeks that overlapped the Republican convention just reading and listening to this stuff. Breitbart, Mark Levin, Michael Savage.
Hannity.
But again, like Hannity and Bill O'Reilly were to the left, because what was going on in the real right, the right that now has glommed on to Trump and loves Trump, was they hated even Fox News. They hated Mitt Romney. They hated Ann Romney. They hated Chris Christie, who was then, you know, a competitive politician in the national arena. And they were contemptuous of Karl Rove. They were contemptuous of the whole Republican National Convention. This went unnoticed. That's my fault, I think. This went unnoticed by the entire mainstream press. It was fascinating to listen to, and you can see how people can get sucked in. And so even now, Fox News is not a real indicator of what's going on. Breitbart is. It's, you know, that's where Steve Bannon, excuse me, comes from. It's big. It has, it has an entertainment site like BuzzFeed. It has comments. It's pretty shocking. And so, yes, the Times and the Washington Post in particular have been terrific in reporting everything they can about Trump.
But it doesn't connect.
Doesn't connect.
And
it
that's the
it tells this, everyone in this yeah. room
that's the
is horrified, but that's the problem.
This is why I'm really interested to hear what Mr. Hewitt has to say in 2 weeks, because I think you're dead on. A once correct view of how this works. It was described in a book about the 2012 campaign called The Gamble, and it's rise, scrutiny, decline. A political figure rises, he or she is subject to scrutiny, and if the flaws are revealed by the press, that person declines.
Like Herman Cain. Or, you know,
Herman Cain is a...
Perfect. Cain the is bubbles the, that rise and right. come down.
So in this case, you have rise, scrutiny, and rise.
Yep.
I mean, I do think that I agree with you completely that while there was malfeasance in the press, particularly on the cable news network's part, turning an hour of time over to his rallies was inexcusable. There was tons of investigative reports all through the campaign. And in a normal situation, if Trump, say, had been a normal Republican candidate, the refusal to back him, which I would point out at one point constituted about 20% of the Republican senators, didn't back him. Four of the last five Republican nominees wouldn't endorse him. And it didn't matter, because the people you're talking about either were responding to that media world you described, or they decided, I think a lot of Republicans that I know who are not in the Breitbart world said, you know what, I really, really, really have problems with Trump, but we can't let Hillary Clinton win or it'll be the Supreme Court for a generation and we'll be doomed. I think that was another part of what went on.
Oh, absolutely, and I think But what we don't know now, which is interesting to me, is recent polls show that however low Trump's approval rating is nationally, it's very high among Republicans.
Yeah.
I mean, it's 85%, 90%. And so I don't know if the media, as we think of the media, can reach those people. Yes, there is a group of Republicans that sort of, you know, the old mainline suburban Republicans that are like George Bush the first, that kind of Republican. There's still some left, and some of them surely voted for Trump because they loathed Hillary for whatever reasons. Not necessarily the Supreme Court. They may have just loathed her for reasons of misogyny or for the feeling that there was some corruption or dishonesty there. Those people are presumably winnable by another Democrat. But I don't know how many of them there are. I'm not sure there are that many of
them. Right. Well, here's one of the most significant numbers of the whole campaign. Trump won 90% of the Republican vote. That is, of people who said they were Republicans, he got 9 out of 10 of them. Because we're in a much more polarized country, where once your team picks its candidate, you vote for that team in a way that 30 years ago, 40 years ago, never happened. You know, Carter got, 25% of the Republican vote. Ford got 25% of Democrats. Just doesn't happen, even with a guy like Trump. I have to ask you about the Russians. The Russians are coming. There seems to be, really nightly on MSNBC, yet another real story, not made up, about various collusions between the Trump people and the Russians and a Russian bank. Do you see this as having any potential to damage Trump?
I think it might. It's different from the other stuff. It's different from Trump University and all the other scams. The fact is, look, the tax returns. We know he didn't pay taxes. We know he had no philanthropy. What is he hiding? We know he was bankrupt multiple times. What is he hiding in these returns? It has to be Russian income, Russian investment. That's what I think. And I think there's obviously stuff there. I mean, there is definitely a there. And I think one way or another, we're going to learn more about it. And luckily, I think for us, the Russians, most Americans still don't like the Russians. They still think it's the Soviet Union. They don't like Putin. And I think that could hurt him. But I don't know. I don't think the sex stuff, if there's a sex tape of him in a hotel room in Moscow, people will probably love it. You know, just wonder why Billy Bush wasn't there that time. But
it's just, if you're as old as I am, the idea that it's the Democrats looking for hints of Moscow gold.
It's ridiculous. It's like the world is turned upside down.
It's a flip of everything that,
But going back to your other point, Jeff, 1 second, about the, I'm holding completely still. I don't know what the hell it is, but.
You think it's Frank's mic? Does this work? Try this.
But this one will still be on.
Oh, you can. Right?
Well, okay.
No, it won't. Try that.
I do think.
No, my question was whether the Russian stories have the capacity to undermine Trump with his base or with the party in a way that all this other stuff didn't. That's where we started. And you thought it might.
I thought it might, because obviously it's something he's guarding so zealously that it must be. There must be something there that's incredibly embarrassing to him.
The Democrats. This may seem heretical, but after it turned out that Jeff Sessions was not entirely forthcoming in that testimony, within a day, 200 House members, I think it was, called on him to resign. And my feeling was, that's awfully quick to that judge. That's like, you know, getting to the finish line. Maybe you want to know more about what happened and whether there's a reason and whether or not, in fact, this was indefensible. I also noticed that there are some Democrats who are complaining that some senators voted to confirm some of Trump's cabinet. Now, is there a sense, do you think, that some Democrats are reacting to this highly unappetizing presidency, in their view, in a way that's a little overwrought? Or are they correct to be saying, resist, block everything he wants to do?
I'm more in that category. I mean, I think whether they vote for different nominees, you know, I mean, look, there are people you should vote against on the merits, like Jeff Sessions, regardless of his Russian contact or not. But I do feel strongly the Democrats should not be a party to rescuing their health care bill. I really don't. I don't think they're overwrought, Democrats. I do feel Democratic Party is a mess for many reasons. That's not one. I mean, the situation on the ground in the whole country is terrible. The state legislatures, governor's mansions, when the surviving leaders of the Democratic Party are essentially de facto Joe Biden, Elizabeth Warren, and Bernie Sanders. Elizabeth Warren is the youngest at 67. That does not reflect well on the party having any kind of bench. I think the DNC probably deserved to be demolished in its Clinton-esque form. As the DNC, the Democratic, there's so much rebuilding to be done. So whatever they can do in Congress to sort of gum up the works, it's fine by me, but I don't think it's going to have a huge impact.
I mean, I do think this is a 10-year story. 10 years ago, the Republicans organized something called Project Red Map, aiming at state legislatures and state races. Mm-hmm. And the Democrats, as Donna Brazile told me in a piece I was writing, you can get the Hollywood elite to come out to a cocktail party for a president, but if you ask them to help out keeping North Carolina legislature from flipping, that's not sexy.
They don't even know what you're talking about.
And the Democratic Party now, I think Frank's exactly right. It is in the worst position it has been in at least since the 1920s, and some of that falls on Barack Obama for taking his enormous organization and devoting it so much and solely to his reelection that it had no role in keeping the Senate or the House or the governor's mansions or the state legislatures in Democratic hands.
I don't disagree.
Speaking of which, so 2018 in a normal environment would be bad news for Trump because every president suffers midterm losses. You look at the map of 2018 in the Senate and you find possibly two vulnerable Republican seats and somewhere between 8 and 10 vulnerable Democratic seats. That is, they are seats held in deeply red states. So in the attempt to reposition itself, do the Democrats move or stay or go left, as some of the progressives want? Or do they do what they did in 2006 and try to recruit as many relatively moderate Democrats that can compete in these red states?
I think there's no one size fits all. I really do. I think it depends. I think you get the most talented candidate if you can find one in each of these states. And probably they'll be self-selecting about their politics from state to state. What concerns me is about the vulnerable parts of, or in general about the 2018 election, is another big story that's going on that's now going to be helped by Jeff Sessions, as it has been by the Roberts Court, is voter suppression, is the attempt to make it, and not just in the Deep South, make it more difficult for minorities to vote, and not just African Americans. So they've got that, too, to deal with, as well as this bad map, and you have a party that is running around like a chicken with its head cut off, basically, as far as I can tell, unless you know something happier about it than I do.
Okay, so we got, just if any of you have questions to send up, I've got 5 more minutes to chat with Frank, and then we will go to your questions, but feel free. Which sort of leads me to the a question I ask almost everybody on who comes to these events, which is if you look to me, it's a contradiction in terms of the foreseeable future. That's an oxymoron. But to the extent that you look ahead, are there reasons to give you, do you have any reasons to be optimistic about what's ahead politically?
I have to say, all my optimism, such as it is, I don't want to overstate it, is out of one belief that this presidency cannot sustain itself. He's not going to be impeached by a Republican Congress. That's just, you know, a liberal fantasy. You look at him, he's 70. We were saying this backstage, he gets no sleep, he eats junk food, he looks terrible. He had no idea what he was getting into. He's bored easily. And part of me feels if things do start to go south, he's not in it for the long haul one way or another. This may be totally self-deluding, but I really feel if things become overwhelming, he's not faced a single crisis yet. There hasn't been a foreign crisis. There hasn't been a war front crisis. There hasn't been terrorism. There hasn't been a Katrina. There hasn't been some huge government screw up that he's going to be held responsible for. So he's just skating on the surface now and not staffing the government even. And I just feel, and it's so a mile a minute, and it's so exhausting. And I think it's also exhausting a lot of the public, maybe even some of his supporters. And part of me feels it may be a problem that's going to take care of itself over time. But maybe crazy.
Could I just point something out to you? Your optimism then rests on the presidency of Pence.
Well, here's my feeling about Mike Pence. Mike Pence is a very conservative, ideological Republican, which Trump isn't. He's horrible on social issues. He's someone who wouldn't have money be allocated for AIDS prevention unless money was set aside to, quote, you know, convert people out of homosexuality. I mean, it's a horrible guy. On the other hand, I think if there's a complete meltdown of the Trump presidency, it's going to be a regent situation. I think everything's going to be up for grabs. And I don't think, quite honestly, that Mike Pence is so clever to sort of do everything that he would want to do in a policy way. He was very unpopular in Indiana as governor of a very conservative state when Trump basically gave him a job because he was going to be out of work.
No, this is...
So I'm not... I feel he's horrible, but I don't feel that he's
okay.
Machiavelli that's going to...
But I think it's important to underline that the notions of impeachment, the notions that the 25th Amendment removal process...
No, that's not happening.
I mean, this is... Aaron Sorkin wouldn't write that.
No, it's just... That's just Democratic...
Actually, he did, but it was a much more plausible way than what we're talking
about. Yeah. No, it's very masturbatory for Democrats to think that that's going to happen, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I do think that's true. This is one errant notion because of what happened in the vote. The idea that we should abolish the Electoral College and go to a pure popular vote presidency.
I'm dying to hear what you think of it, because you've written about it in a real way. I remember, you know, being like in the fourth grade and learning the concept. Right. What is this? Yeah. You know, it didn't make any sense then, and the teacher could never explain it.
I understand.
And
somewhere in around 88, I went out. I was working with Nightline. We went out and interviewed people in the street about the Electoral College, and it was like jaywalking. You know, I'd say, "What do you think of the Electoral College?" And the person said, "I don't live here. I'm from out of town." That's quite literally. But you know, here's the problem. It's another fantasy, okay? You need a constitutional amendment, or you need this. There are actually people trying to do the following. They're trying to get state legislatures to sign onto a deal where, because state legislatures can do whatever they want with their electors. They don't even have to let you vote for them. They can pick them themselves. The idea is they will assign their electors to whoever wins the national popular vote. And if there are enough states with 270 electoral votes or more that sign on to this, what you have is a backdoor abolition of the Electoral College. That's not going to happen either.
No, because it's not in the interests of the states that have undue power, have disproportionate power to approve it. It's like, look, growing up in Washington, D.C., when I was a kid, there was literally no vote. You couldn't even vote in a presidential election in D.C. until 1964. Statehood was always then the cause, but there's never going to be. And my father, who was a businessman but got very involved in late in life in D.C. statehood and campaigning for it and very sincerely, but it was never going to happen because Republicans were never going to let it happen as long as it was a substantial, often a majority black population in D.C., which meant, as things exist now, it was always going to be electoral votes and two senators that would be Democratic. So it's never, it's not, you know, it may happen in some demographic evolution after
what
we're all gone.
What I think is slightly more likely, although the Trump victory may have changed us, there were moves on in states that had always voted Democratic but with Republican legislatures to change the electoral vote to a congressional district vote rather than winner-take-all by state. So in other words, if it had been happened in 2012, Obama won Pennsylvania, but under that system, he only would have gotten one more electoral vote. I'm not sure they're going to stay with that because Trump won a lot of the battlegrounds. But anyway, it's a fantasy. The popular vote's a fantasy. The 25th Amendment's a fantasy. Impeachment's a fantasy. An indictment of Donald Trump by the new U.S. attorney is also unlikely. So you're going to have to hang in. So we've got some questions here. Let's go to the first one. And the winner is La La Land. You know, we just got to bet better people. All right, let me try the real question. How do journalists cross the informational divide? How do we get, say, a relative who gets their views from Breitbart to believe credible news sources?
Forget it. I certainly have at least one relative like that who lives in New York City, and no, he's, you know, and it's not stupid. He's not going to, no, he's dug in.
You know, I think it's called the confirmation bias, but behavioral psychologists have discovered, and I have to tell you, this crosses ideological lines here. If you find someone with a deeply held belief and you confront that person with evidence that says that belief is wrong, they will redouble the original belief. The idea that people, this is one thing that behavioral psychology has taught us, and it's very unsettling, is the idea that we are these rational thinking people, you know, whether it's how we invest in stock or make decisions about who we marry or whatever, that this is all done like rational man, meaning men and women, that ain't the way it works. And I'll give you one example from this. The last 3 years have been the hottest years in record. Mm-hmm. That's just a fact. It doesn't tell you why. It doesn't necessarily prove climate change is wrong. It's just a fact. I believe I'm right in saying the majority of Trump voters rejected that information. That is, no, that's not true. Because we all know climate change is a hoax. So the question of how you get people to change deeply held views by showing them evidence.
Look, Trump had the largest inaugural crowd in history, period. Who do you believe, him or your eyes?
That's right. Groucho Marx lives. But the most important part about that is it has had no impact. All of these statements, 3 million of illegal voters, that's why I lost the popular vote. Obama, I just learned Obama had me wiretapped. He learned it at 6:35 on a Saturday morning in his bathroom. It gives great pleasure, you know, it's great fodder for the late night comics. But that ain't what's happening.
And that's why also this question, you know, you've answered. I mean, it'd be nice, but there's another piece of it too, which is the way that most people, I imagine, in this room consume news is increasingly not going to be the way people consume news anyway. They're not going to be looking at the New York Times or CBS or New York Magazine, or they're getting, you know, there's a whole change there too, where people read stuff and don't know where it comes from, don't even know the provenance of it, and it will be, as we've learned in Facebook, often selected to confirm what you already think or believe or the sources you already trust, not the ones you mistrust.
Okay, first, I meant to mention this. Ghostlight is one of the most moving autobiographies I've ever read. That's Frank's evocation of growing up in and around Washington. It really is a terrific book. Question, as a former columnist for the New York Times, oh, that's you, I'm sorry. Do you believe that the Times is out to get Trump? And is it in fact the failing New York Times? But that's actually an interesting question, because the Times recently has been undergoing the same kind of, or some of the same financial pressures as every other print publication, but something's happened on the other side, right? Digitally.
Yeah, well, of course, I'm hardly conversant with the numbers within the New York Times business, but I think that, first of all, the Times is not out to get Trump. It was thought to be out to get Clinton and thought to be out to get Bush. And you have to distinguish the news reporting from the editorial page. It is a liberal editorial page, but it's trying to be fair, and it's trying to be hard-hitting, and it's been hard-hitting against plenty of Democratic politicians, including certainly Hillary Clinton and Andrew Cuomo and Elliot Spitzer and many others we could name. The failing New York Times thing of Trump is just like, you know, crooked Hillary. He gives these, this is his idea of being witty, and giving it, putting a, you know, and impressing his own supporters. What's happening at the Times is happening at every major respected news organization, such as, there are not that many left, unfortunately, in the country, is they're in a race to figure out how to make money when there's no print and there's no print advertising. And, you know, if you read the print Times, you know, you can see how thin it is, and that's not the Times' fault. You know, remember when it wasn't that long ago, there'd be like three, you know, thick sections on a Sunday paper of real estate ads and help wanted ads. That's all gone. And every other kind of print advertising is drying up. So what the Times is trying to do, as is New York Magazine, The New Yorker, The Washington Post, is figure out a way to get it on people's phones, essentially, because that's where the audience is, and getting them to pay for it. Because while there is, while the digital numbers of people looking at it can be large, advertising, right. Digital advertising doesn't pay very much. And if they're getting it for free, then where are you? Right. And so they're in that race. And you know, you look at there've been some standing outside it, because I haven't worked there in more than five years, but just standing outside it as a reader and a fan of the Times, if you look at the changes, the redesign of the art section, the redesign of the first two pages, the first spread after the front page, this is all, to me, taking stuff that actually is being developed for the iPhone and putting it there. Little nuggets, news you can use, facts you might like.
But then there's the other side, where you open up the New York Times and you know it's coming from the front page. You can see how they're laying out that four column thing with lots of white space and pictures. And I open the print and I shudder, because I know what I'm facing. I'm facing two full pages of text. Thousands and thousands of words. Kind of like the North Korean,
right,
you know, State of the Union speech. And I'm wondering, is that going to survive in an era of phones?
No, it's not. It's for those of us who came up with that or like to write long form journalism, there'll still be a market for it, but it's not going to be the mass market.
Okay.
Once was.
Governor John Kasich said on NBC today that both major political parties are disintegrating. True or false? And if true, what then? Are we entering an era of celebrity politics?
Well, I think, yes, they're both disintegrating. I don't think the center holds in either party, and Trump has captured the Republican Party. He believes a lot of what they believe in, but he has sort of made the, you know, for now at least, he's sort of taken over the party. The Democrats we discussed earlier, does that necessarily mean that that leads to full celebrity politics? Not necessarily, but it does mean both these parties are really going to have to rebuild themselves.
The most significant thing maybe that happened in the entire campaign was that the institutional forces that some of us old timers thought were still around within the party structure weren't. That is, in another time, there's no way Donald Trump would have been the nominee of the Republican Party. He would have been ruled off the boards by the powers that be. It turns out there were no powers that be.
Yep.
It was an empty shell. And while that doesn't necessarily suggest celebrity politics in the flippant way, it does suggest, for instance, that the next Democratic presidential nominee might not come from the list that agonizingly is already being churned out. It might be some billionaire, high-tech guy with a populist message that violates some of the Democratic Party identity politics stuff. I'm not a predictor, but what we do know is that these parties, and Bernie Sanders almost proved it, these parties do not have the kind of structure that many of us grew up with. You know, I still have a copy of a 1960 Life magazine showing the kingmakers coming to Los Angeles to nominate the Democrat. They're right. All portly, middle-aged, elderly white guys with hats and suits and coats.
That's all gone. And look, I would argue even Obama in 2008,
yeah.
He beat the Clinton machine. No one thought that could. So this has been happening for a while, and it seems to me sort of the last gasp of the old way with the nominations of Romney and the Republicans and Hillary Clinton last year.
And that was it. Why do you think, this is an interesting question, why do you think Obama did not prosecute any of the Wall Street criminals?
I don't know. I think it was a mistake. I strongly feel it was a mistake. To me, it's one of the big mysteries. I'm an Obama fan, but this to me is the single biggest failure of his administration. Is it because the Democratic donor class is just like the Republican donor class, basically? It's people who are in that business. He's surrounded by people like Larry Summers, who worked for a hedge fund before he went to work for the Obama administration. But I don't know. Do you have a theory about it?
I can tell you that at least one of the people closest to Obama thinks it was a mistake not to.
I'm not close
big
to
mistake.
Him,
but I think the other thing is, first of all, who did he bring into the administration? Who were the people advising him?
It's the Robert Rubin, the same Robert Rubin Summers coterie that was with the Clintons.
Right.
No, I think that's
and
where
the second
it came
thing
from.
Was, in fairness, we were dancing along the edge of the abyss. We were fairly close, certainly closer than ever since 1930s, to a genuine, complete economic meltdown. And he may have felt that, or the decision makers around him may have said to him, "Look, we're pumping credit into these banks. We hate doing this, but if we don't do this, the system's going to collapse." And bringing some of these guys into the criminal dock right now, it's just too dicey. That's the best I can come up with.
Yeah, but I can certainly understand that in 2009 and 2010. But as time went on, you look at the mortgage stuff alone and Countrywide and all this, I don't get it.
Like I say, there are people very close to Obama who think that politically it was a mistake.
Definitely was politically a mistake.
Because it helped roil the whole Tea Party thing. Remember, the Tea Party was not right-wing in the sense of being pro-Wall Street. They hated Wall Street almost as much as they hated the media and welfare cheats and Obama.
Right. And by the way, Trump, although obviously it's different now that he's in there, but Trump ran attacking Clinton for her Wall Street connections and Obama. It was complete, horseshit. But he did. That's how, he knew that that's what people wanted.
Absolutely.
And you know.
I don't know how to answer this question. Will Jeff Sessions be prosecuted or asked to resign?
No.
That's my bet. He's too close to, it's not a Michael Flynn situation, which I have to say, Veep wouldn't.
No, that was.
Do that. That's this stuff, getting paid $500,000 from Turkey while you are the national security advisor and you write op-ed pieces saying Turkey's great. You just, you
and sitting in on an intelligence briefing, sitting in on President-elect's intelligence briefings, it's unbelievable.
This is for you in your other role. What can you tell us about your next executive producing role at HBO, Succession?
Oh.
Yes.
Someone is reading the trades or something. This is a drama series that we made a pilot at the end of the year, and it's been picked up, and it's now going to be written and made into a series. But it's literally we're just starting to write it. But it's about a international media tycoon who lives in New York and his adult children fighting for succession. And well, you know,
is there a kangaroo in here? I sense something Australian going on.
When it was written, you know, sure, there's a little bit of Sumner Redstone, a little bit of Murdoch, and so on. When we shot it, it was just after Trump was elected. We said, wait a minute, these kids are like the Trumps, but we didn't change anything. But it's a very, I think, you know, look, obviously I like it, I'm involved with it, but it's the idea is it'll be, you know, somewhat sophisticated, and it's not about anyone in particular, and it's really about families and power, and has a really good cast, Brian Cox and Jeremy Strong and Kieran Culkin and Peter Friedman and some people you haven't heard of. But anyway, it should be fun. I hope it is.
So here's a semi-optimistic question, if I can understand it. If the new administration is a caricature of our no-discretion society, is there a chance that we're simply in a process of experimentation that will drive us back to a society and a politics based on more decorum and fact-based disclosure?
Look, pendulums do swing. I would like to believe there's a chance of that. I have no idea. Do you? What do you think?
Well, I'll tell you what. I don't know why I remember this, but back in the somewhere in the '60s, the then editor of Esquire, Arnold Gingrich was his name, wrote a piece. Censorship was ending, and books and movies were becoming much more explicit. And he said, "But you know, there's a pendulum." And the pendulum's going to swing back. Well, no. not based on the movies and the stuff that's around now. No. So there is a theory politically that politics swings. You know, Arthur Schlesinger has this notion of a 12-year cycle. But I think if we've seen anything this last election, that theory seems to me dubious. And I certainly don't. The only way you could reach that optimistic conclusion, I think, is if in fact the Trump presidency were to implode in a way that, at this point, neither of us think is possible. I mean, genuinely implode with some kind of event that is so outraged that even the Republicans in Congress say no.
I think it's possible. I think it's possible because government would implode, not because a scandal would bring him down, because the government just won't function because he doesn't know how to make it function, you know. And I'm not saying it in some kind of snobby way, like, oh, he's not been around Washington to know all the ins and outs of the ways and means. I mean, he really doesn't understand the idea that you can't just do everything by either tweeting or picking up the phone and telling Carrier Corporation to hire, you know, 1,000 more people. So that could all backfire in a real world. But even if that happened, would the pendulum swing? But I don't know.
You reminded me of something that at some point I'm going to put down in print or pixels or whatever we do. One of the enormous, I don't know if irony is the right word because that's a word everybody misuses.
Right.
The extent to which Trump is the bizarro version of every Hollywood liberal notion about politics. That is, I don't know how many movies there are, going back to Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, Meet John Doe, 9 to 5, it's a Sally Field movie, Norma Rae. It's this person who violates, doesn't play the game, you know.
I wrote about this when you started, because it's Bulworth.
Yeah.
It's the guy in Robert Altman's Nashville.
But it's
Bob Roberts, that movie.
But I'm talking only about the liberal stuff. Yeah. Roberts is kind of like dystopian. But I mean, the hero of these movies, you know, comes from the great unwashed. They're the salt of the earth. And the big shots, Edward Arnold, usually, in a tuxedo, smoking a cigar with a top hat. And it's the people, try and stop them. It's that, well, Trump in a, if you can get stoned enough or something, that's part of his appeal. I always thought from the one thing I thought from the beginning was everything that we thought was a bug was a feature. His vulgarity, the ostentatious display of wealth, the in-your-face, you know, giving the middle finger.
I agree.
This is what we've been waiting for. A lot of people, we've been waiting for somebody to say this to you sons of bitches.
Yeah, and for a while, it was hugely entertaining.
Yeah.
Horrible way, but yes. And also, no, I think that's exactly the case. And look, his favorite, you never know what to believe in anything he says, you know, but he has repeatedly said that his favorite movie is Citizen Kane. And there is, you could see, you know, there is that kind of, that Hearst is presented in that movie. That's, you know.
Well, for the first half hour, maybe.
Yeah, first half hour. Then, yeah, well, then Susan
Alexander.
Do you see
Trump in the tower saying, you know, Rosebud?
No.
Do you think, here's the... It's an interesting picture.
Yeah, it's a great sketch for somebody.
Do you think he'll do permanent damage to the country? It's a serious note, but it's the right one to end on, because that is something that I think is worth contemplating. Even if he's only there for 4 years or even less. I mean, the traditional notion is the country's too strong, the guardrails are too high, you know, the institutions are too ingrained. And I'm not talking about him becoming a dictator or fantasy like that. It's a different question.
Just wreck everything. Wreck the environment, wreck the economy, wreck civil rights, wreck voting. You know, I guess I want to be less pessimistic. I think he's going to do a lot of short-term damage. There's no question. He's already doing it. I do sort of feel the country is stronger than being so easily wrecked. I do believe that the people who really are his base, we're talking about, we may be talking about a majority of the Republican Party, an overwhelming majority of the Republican Party, but we're still talking about at most 35% of the country, and maybe less. And it's the same group, by the way, that loved Nixon to the end, like George Wallace, you know. And I feel, look, if he can wreck it that easily, then we've been deluding ourselves the entire history of the country, and not a damn thing we can do about it. But I somehow feel, no, I think it's going to be a terrible few years, but and really hard on people not like us, people who are undocumented immigrants, people who have whose civil rights are going to be threatened, citizens whose civil rights are going to be threatened by him. People are not going to be able to vote because of him, and people are going to be flim-flam by much bigger scams than Trump University as he gets his hands on them. But I don't think we're going to end up in nuclear war, and I don't think the whole country is going to collapse. Do you agree?
Yeah, I do. I think there is a, you know, the dead white guys did a pretty good job a couple hundred years ago building as of course, they weren't dead then, I should point out, channeling a police squad. No, but they built a system that has an awful lot of protections in it, and you don't throw 200 plus years out, and I'm not even sure, you know, the ultimate fantasy, I suppose, beyond impeachment and 25th Amendment, is that somebody comes to Trump, maybe it's his daughter, I don't know, and says, and appeals to the one thing you know is the most important part of Trump's life, which is his ego, and say, do you want to be one of the great presidents? Do you want to be that fifth face on Mount Rushmore? Although how they do that hair, I don't know. Here's what will help you do that. And maybe he becomes something else. And I'll end on this note, if I may, because it's a story that a wise woman told me that her mother said to her at the end of a very long and very unhappy marriage. The mother said, "We could have had a great life if only your father had been a completely different person." And on that note...